Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Unmasking Humanity 21 Questions with Joshua T. Berglan. Today we have an amazing guest, a man that is after my own heart, and I don't mean it like that, but he is going to discuss, or these 21 questions that we have today are powerful. And again, this subject matter is so important that we all pay attention. And no, I'm not your mommy and daddy. I'm not lecturing you. I'm not trying to tell you what to do. But what Michael has to say is very, very important, especially with the day and age that we're in, where there's so much misinformation. There is so much AI-created content out there that is designed for the sole purpose of deceiving you. And look, I am all for truth, but the fact is this, it is very, very challenging to know what truth is in this day and age. I like to believe the only truth that we know comes from within. But even that can be cloudy sometimes, especially with what we feed our minds with day in, day out. I've been made it very, very clear from the very beginning of every broadcast I've ever done. I don't choose sides. I'm not here to say I'm Republican or Democrat, because honestly, I believe choosing either one of those sides is foolhardy. But that said, people are going to do it. So what I want to do and what my goal is with this broadcast today is to shift perspective. To hopefully, regardless of what side you've chosen, because I know most of you have chosen a side, I'm hoping that today's conversation will help you quit looking to the left or right, but begin to look straight and look within. Because right now we need truth in this world, and we need it bad. Because I believe as painful as the truth will be, that is the only way we will ever be set free. And I believe our guest today, Mr. Michael Dorfman, is going to do that. So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Michael Dorfman to Unmasking Humanity, 21 Questions with Joshua T. Berglan. Michael, how are you, sir?
Okay, feeling good. That was quite an introduction to this, what we're going to be talking about today. It's really wonderful.
Well, thank you. And I want to say, I actually want to give you a thank you really quick, because you were the very first person, you should have been the first guest, but you were the very first person that I talked about this new concept with, 21 questions, and I pitched it to you, and you're the one goes, I really like that idea. And so I created it because you love the idea. Like you, so I would have done it anyway, but I had a lot more confidence doing it based on your reaction. So I want to express my gratitude to you, because by of all the broadcasts I've created, this is my favorite one, so thank you.
Do you remember what the first thing you said or you wrote when I contacted you?
No, I forgot.
You said, thank you, you made my day.
Well, you and did.
I know, it was like, what? It was amazing.
You've actually made plenty of my days, because this is number 10, I think. I've done 10 now, and you're the 10th one, and I got to tell you, they've all been special in just completely different ways. So I owe you, I should give you a production credit or something, because you helped me with this idea. But this is not about me. Today is about you. But the very first question I want to ask you that's not part of the 21 questions is, what are you grateful for today and why?
I'm grateful to be alive. In this day, today, because of what's happening, it's very exciting for me, and I feel that at my age, I'm 82 years old, I found a mission in my life, that is to share what I'm learning. And what I'm learning is just, you know, a combination of my experience and my research, and now I have a chance, and, you know, I've been looking forward to this podcast, because you know, I just see where you're coming from, and I believe that it's going to be a great opportunity for me.
No, it's a great opportunity for me too. A kindred spirit in seeking truth and telling the truth and helping people wake up out of their fog is something that, you know, I'm passionate about, because we're not each other's enemies. We're not. And we're going to need each other really bad soon. And so I hope that this broadcast helps start to shift the narrative, shift the narrative to truth for a lot of people. So with that said, are you ready for 21 questions?
Okay, I'm ready.
Okay, here we go. Question one. This is an easy one. What inspired you to become an investigative author?
It's been going on, my investigations, my doubting of what the information we've been receiving throughout my whole life has really affected me. And I was, you know, especially when I got into being a plant-based a vegan, that was my first opportunity to really see where we've been manipulated and where we're not being told the truth. And that's where I wrote my first book. And at that first book, I didn't think I was an investigative author. But then when I wrote my second book, which was the information warfare book, I saw that, hey, that's what I'm doing. You know, maybe I'm not an investigative journalist, but now that's what I'm doing as an author. And it's just, that's what I do. I just investigate. I could say that I do 2 or 3 hours a day of searching. It became such a passion for me. I'm just committed to it. And it gets more and more exciting as, you know, time goes by.
I love it. Number two, how do you define information warfare?
Well, there's warfare that's going on between countries, you know, the actual warfare, the fighting. But to me, behind it all is this information warfare, which is, it's like almost like a tug of war going on between different information that's being out there in the media, and they're just going against each other. And here you see these two sides pulling and pushing, and that's what the warfare is. And we're in the middle. We have to see, well, which side are we going to go on? You know, we got to choose between this crazy warfare that's going on, that's you know, flooding the media.
Oh, and it's about to get worse too.
Oh, for sure.
I mean, right now we have people competing against AI, you know, for their social proofs. Like, there's robotic influencers now. And so for all the people that have stepped into content creation and they're trying to monetize their gifts and their talents or their YouTube channels, like, they're now literally competing against robots, just like humans are with other things. It's just such an interesting time. But also, the news with the AI-generated content is becoming so hard to decipher between what's real and what's not, even with the safety measurements that are supposedly being put in place. It's a very interesting time.
Yeah, it's interesting. I had my first chance to check out AI. Is it okay if I go on? This is not one of the questions, I guess.
Yeah, you can say whatever. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. So I was writing my book, and I decided to get, I got ChatGPT, and I just put in, it was for my second, the book I just finished, and it was, I put in some information, and I asked, you know, the AI, can you make a poem out of this? And I put in the information, it was like just a few points, and in less than 5 seconds, it came out with a poem that had like about 8 different stanzas, and it was perfect rhyming. It was like 5 seconds, and it was like, holy shit, that's scary stuff, you know? So, and now, you know, it's interesting also because my son, Adam, he uses AI a lot, and my other son is scared about it because of the dangers of AI. And I see there's both sides, and we have to realize that this can be used for good, or it can be used for evil. And that's what's going on right now.
Perfect. That's so well said. I have nothing to add to that. It was great. Question three. Oh, here, this one's right up your alley. What are the primary tactics used by governments and corporations to manipulate information?
Well, they use different tactics. One is cherry picking. In other words, they'll take some information out and they'll give it to you, and that will be, you know, what you see and either accept or not accept. And then you have the repeating. repeating a lie. You know, I don't know if you know that who had said if you repeat it, if a lie repeated once is a lie, a lie repeated a thousand times becomes the truth. And that was said by Goebbels, who was the head of information manipulation for Hitler. His propaganda minister.
Yeah. There you go.
Yeah. And the other thing is just, funding articles, funding information that they want you to hear and that you just listen to. And what else is there? There's just finding ways to intimidate people and false claims against experts. You know, that's another way they do that. And that's what they, you know, with through censoring and even threatening people for losing their jobs and, you know, people who want to speak the truth or have it. Well, I'm not going to say the truth or alternate opinions, you know, their own points of view, sure. Which we have to listen to. Yeah.
Yeah, that's really good information too. Our country, specifically in the United States, is the most media illiterate country of all countries. One of the ways I can prove that, other than the fact that I wrote a book on the subject, is that you can look up the search terms by country, media literacy, just those two words. Americans don't search for that word and they don't really even understand it. But if you go to Africa or Asia, Europe, anywhere else, they're much more media literate. In fact, they teach media literacy because it's so important for us to know. Like, we need this information. And you said something about when you were talking about the truth. What is truth anymore? You know, like, how do we really even know? Because you can see the most well, I mean, it's so easy to forge or create forgeries or make mocks or duplicates or use AI to make something look real that's not. I mean, we have deep fake masks. We have so many things that were created to help deceive. I'm not comfortable walking around telling people I know the truth about anything except for what I hear inside, what I'm prompted to do. And then if I go do it, I'm like, oh, okay, so that was true. I should have followed that. But that's about the only truth I know anymore.
But that's what we have to do. We have to. That's why, for me, the most important thing is to, you know, the problem is here in the U.S., for example. Well, I'm living in Mexico, but like I'm still an American citizen. And it's just, you know, we're just being fed one side of the story. And you see it happening now. It's unbelievable how we're just getting one side of the story. And for some reason, so many Americans are not even interested in listening to the other side of the story. In fact, if you come to me with the other side of the story, it's like, what are you talking about? You know, it's like, and it started way back. To me, this big change started with the real big change started with the pandemic. Yeah. But that's when the info, it just was completely turned around.
Yeah, and I'll keep my comments to that silent because I don't want this broadcast to get taken down.
Okay.
on my own platform.
All right.
Actually, you have the freedom to say what you want, so you can speak freely. All right, number four. Can you provide examples? Can you provide examples on how mainstream media promotes specific agendas? Give a real world example of media manipulation.
Okay, well, I could talk about, to me, which is the most existential issue of today, which is the wars that are going on. Mm-hmm. You know, so for example, one of the articles I write about in my book is called "We Are Not Afraid of Thermonuclear War." And I went through this whole time when I was a kid. It was World War, you know, it was the Cold War. And we were scared shit of a thermonuclear war. I mean, we were, when I was a kid, you know, maybe some of your listeners, you know, even had that experience of we went to school and we were told that in case of a thermonuclear war, you had a duck and cover, which you go under your desk so you don't get, I mean, if a bomb hits, it's like you're under your desk. Okay, that sounds really weird now. but we went through that. And it was like we were so afraid of the of a thermonuclear war because we had, you know, we knew about what happened in Japan, and then there were bombs that were dropped. I mean, even in they kept on exploding these bombs, and the most powerful bomb in history was exploded by Russia in 1961, and that was called the Tsar Bomba, and it was like 1,000 times more powerful than the ones dropped in Japan. And now you have people talking about a tactical nuclear weapon, and it's like, what are you talking about? But the problem is, the more that you listen to it, oh, it's okay, we can have a small little nuclear attack here, small nuclear attack there, and it's like, and where is this all going to end? It's going to end in the thermonuclear war, because it's not going to happen the way they think it's going to happen. But that's what we're believing, and it goes back to what you said about we're not being informed, we're being lied to, we're being manipulated.
Yeah, 100%, 100%, which segues beautifully into this next question. What role does social media play in information warfare?
Well, the social media is the one that's being used by these groups, by the industries, by corporation, by who's behind the curtain, you know, could be the military industrial complex that's, using the social media. But social media is already sold out, I mean, you know, to so many different groups, you know, including, you know, Google, Twitter, you know, Facebook. You know, I was censored and blocked on Facebook because I had a strong Facebook page. This was on Go Whole Food Vegan, which was my vegan Facebook page, and I started writing about food and nutrition. And we created, my wife and I, who created the Vegan Wave in Spanish. And she started putting her recipes up there in Spanish, but writing about, you know, substituting alternate milks, you know, whether it's almond milk, soy milk, for regular milk, because they're less fat, it could be healthier for people. And that's it. That was the end of my promoting my Facebook page. And to this very, this was 2 years ago, and to this very day, I'm not allowed to promote my Facebook page. So that's what they did to me, and that's what they're doing to other people. Anybody who goes against the narrative is going to be censored, intimidated, blocked, any one of those things. That's what's the problem.
Yeah, I've been kicked off a few times. I got kicked off my own network.
I'm sure of that.
Oh, well, I won't bring up those subjects right now, but yeah. I've had my experience too, and I going back on social media now, years later, I'm like shocked by what I'm seeing, because we have a lot of naive people that are betting their whole careers and putting all of their intellectual property and everything of value they have on social media. They're falling into these traps of choosing a side one way or the other. They're being manipulated with every TikTok video that comes. I mean, what a time to be alive is all I got to say. Question six, how can individuals protect themselves from misinformation?
Well, I think the first thing that has to happen is, you have to reach a point where you have to doubt something, you know, it's something, because there's so much power on the other side that's flooding it with this information and manipulation of information. but something has to come through. And, you know, for example, but I don't know, you may not, it's something I may not be allowed to talk about.
Oh, you can talk about it.
All right, I'll talk about it.
I got to be careful what I say. Yeah, you can say what you want.
Yeah, I'm talking about the big one, the vaccines. So, you know, the vaccines came out and they promised that it was going to be, you won't get sick, you won't get the, you know, COVID, you won't spread COVID. That was the promise, okay? And then it ended up that it didn't matter really, because even if you got the vaccine or not, you got sick or you still spread it, you know? And this was, these promises were made, you know, by the president, by the head of CDC, by Fauci. They literally said this stuff. And it's like, and I have it, it's like, they said this stuff. And then all of a sudden, it's like, okay, there's one incident that you, if you were aware, it's like, hey, and maybe you got 5 or 6 boosters or whatever, and you're not sure if you want to get, okay, if you're not sure, maybe you should start checking it out. You know, get some more information to make sure that you know, that you want to make sure that if you make it, if you could make the correct decision or not. So I think it's like, it's got to reach a point where there's some doubt, is, you know, some reason for you to say, hey, this doesn't make sense. And something, when something doesn't make sense, it's like it touches you inside, you know, because you have the mind that says, well, this is information. But when something is like, wait a second, I don't know if I go along with that. That's the point. That could be a point where you start doubting. And I think that has to happen, that you have to start doubting that, and you start investigating, and then the door can open up. And then you could find out, and it's out there. I mean, I go into Facebook, not the Facebook, I go into Google, and I find what I want. It's amazing how Google still allows a lot of this stuff to be, you know, going on, because it may not go along with their policies. But I you know, and I know who to listen to, and I said, no, well, they, because that's also manipulated. You know, they take it, but if you really get into it and start, you know, investigating, and, you know, this, you start this discovering, hey, this sounds right. I like these people. I like what they're saying. They sound like they're coming from a good place, and I trust their information more than I trust others. So I think that that's the first thing that happens in order to protect ourselves. Because, you know, if it ends up that the vaccine causes harm, like it's showing, especially, you know, in children and young people, it's like, do you really want to go ahead with it? You know, that's what I think. And I know people it's happened to.
I can say what I'm about to say without getting in trouble, because now it's been proven. I think I'm safe to say what I'm about to say. But if anyone watched Event 201 5 years ago, if anyone read The Fourth Industrial Revolution or The Great Reset by Klaus Schwab, you would know exactly what's happening, has been happening the last 4 years, because they told everybody exactly what was going to happen, what the Great Reset was, what the Fourth Industrial Revolution will entail. And while people were getting offended by the clips that they saw when they heard Noah from the World Economic Forum talking about people being useless eaters, if you actually watched the whole video, you would understand why that term is used, because we're going to have two classes of people. We're going to have people that sit back and take the universal basic income, and we're going to have the people that take the instructions that were given to them by the World Economic Forum of how you succeed in the Fourth Industrial Revolution, and they're going to go succeed. You're going to have a slave class, and then you're going to have the working class, and the working class are going to be people that actually followed the instructions, that didn't buy into the fear, that knew exactly what was playing out, because they literally told everybody years, or they told everybody a year before it was going to happen, what was going to happen. And if anyone paid attention to Agenda 21 and saw, because we got to see Agenda 21 play out in our life. So why in the world would you not pay attention to Agenda 2030 if Agenda 21 happened? And that, for me, when I saw, for me, here's how I knew that, wait a second, something's not right, is when I first heard about Agenda 21 from Alex Jones, of all people, because I was a conspiracy theorist. I was. When I watched it play out, I knew in my mind that who I needed to be listening to and who I didn't. and who I didn't need to be listening to was coming through my television screen. Who I needed to be listening to were the people that were in power that made the decisions for our lives. And that's the World Economic Forum and the United Nations. So the last 4 years, I prepared. I prepared my business. I prepared everything, waiting for the switch. And that switch is about to happen. And everyone, especially Americans, the majority of Americans are going to be blindsided. And they're going to feel like they got robbed like a thief in the night. Because they're going to go, what happened? What happened? But literally all of the information was in front of our face, what was happening the whole time.
But maybe there's still time. You know, I think that the only way is out is that people have to wake up, because we have to realize that what's going on, and the World Economic Forum, the World Health Organization, you know, pushing this through. But, you know, it gets down to the individual. We don't have to go along with that if we really understand what's going on. If we really can wake up, I don't know if it's getting off the grid. I don't know exactly what's happening. I have, the good news I felt was from the World Health Organization is that it didn't go through this with the vaccine at that point. It still could, but if 8 billion people decide not to get the vaccine, regardless of what their government wants them to do, it's not going to happen. So it's 8 billion people against how many? 100, 150 people? We are the majority, but that we have to wake up. You know, it's a tough situation, right? Like exactly what you're saying. But, and I don't know, because we're heading, you know, with what's going on now with the wars and everything, you know, we got to wake up to the fact that this is really where we're going. You know, I'm a football fan, and I'm waiting for the football season to start. And I just see, you know, when you go into the TV, people don't even know. It's like, that's what's important. You know, the football games are coming up. No. You can watch the football game if you want, but this is what's really going on. And that's what the problem is.
Yeah, there is. And this is not my broadcast, so I'm going to keep the rest of my opinions to myself here. But you really excite me with the subject matter, because it's right in my wheelhouse of what I've dedicated my life to learning. So I'm enjoying this. Thank you. Question 7. What are the long-term effects of consuming manipulated information?
The long-term effects of consuming manipulative information is that you're going to be completely controlled. That you're gonna do whatever they tell you to do, just like what happened in 1984, you know, and that was it, you know, and I mean, there's no two ways about it. And a lot of people, my friends, are in that situation, and I'm trying, believe me, I'm trying to convince them that do you really believe that? And it's like, yeah. So that's what the long-term effects are. You're going to be manipulated, and you're going to do what they want you to do, just like you're doing right now.
Mm-hmm. You nailed it. Number 8, how does your book, The Thriving Vegan, relate to your work on information warfare?
Okay. That's where it all started. I think one of the first things I really got interested in was the cigarette companies and what they did between, you know, starting in the 1940s and 50s. Everybody was smoking. And it was completely, I was smoking cigarettes when I was 12. Wow. And we used to wait for somebody to, because you couldn't buy cigarettes then, but it was healthy. How could we not smoke cigarettes? My parents are smoking. They just loved when they got their carton of cigarettes. It was like the greatest present in the world, you know? So, but the problem was, and then it was, they promoted it, you know, the cigarette companies were promoting it by, getting doctors and athletes, you know, and the movies, everybody in the 40s and 50s, you saw movies, everybody was smoking. So everybody still was smoking. But, and then, and finally it came out with the, you know, the main doc, the Surgeon General came out with, you know, the link between smoking and cancer. And what they did, people didn't know, is that between that, the 40s and the 60s, 20 years, there were already thousands of studies showing the link between cancer and cigarette smoking and cancer. And that was the first, that's what they did. They had so much power. These cigarette companies had so much power, and it reduced, you know, the amount of people smoking, but not completely. But that was my first, you know, the first time that I got really interested in that. And then when I wrote my book, I had my big experience. You know, I became plant-based, and then that was like 16 years ago, and one of the turning points for me, and why I wanted to really share this, and I really saw that this is what I wanted to do, was when Beatrice, a friend of ours, got a heart attack. She had quadruple bypass surgery, and she was only given 6 months to live. And I was already doing plant-based and reading books, and I saw that there were doctors that were having success with nutrition and lifestyle in healing people that heart disease, serious heart disease. There was one heart specialist, well, the surgeon, Esselstein, Caldwell Esselstein, who is the head of one of the top surgeons in the Cleveland Clinic. He was doing bypass surgery, and he wrote this book in Prevent and Reverse Heart Disease. And I lent her the book, and she did it, and she read it. And instead of living the 6 months, she lived 8 years. And it turned her around. And to me, that was like, what's going on here? How come doctors aren't telling? How come that is not the go-to, you know, the go-to path to getting healthy should be nutrition? But nobody talks about it. Doctors don't talk about it. And then I find out why, because they don't know about it and they don't learn about it. So what they do is they use either pills, surgery, or radiation, or chemo, whatever, you know, that's what they do. And and that started me. It's like, okay, I got to tell people about this. And that started, you know, writing, doing articles, doing presentations here in San Miguel, where I am. Then it just went on, and then I saw that, wait a second, it's not just happening with health, it's happening with, you know, the pandemic, it's happening with climate change, it's happening with wars, it's happening with, you know, just different things. And I didn't even open up to a lot of other things that are, you know, are happening. So it's with so many global issues, the manipulation, yeah.
It really is. And so that leads really well into the next question, but I'm going to modify it a little bit because you kind of answered it. There's obviously a ton of information about plant-based diets. There's tons of documentation proving that it's a great diet for people. But there's also a lot of really good information about the carnivore diet doing some of the same things. So with that said, can you talk about the evidence that you know of that supports why a vegan plant-based diet is the way to go?
Okay. I've sort of changed my mind a little bit. And I can go on to say, because I'm a whole food plant-based. I've been doing this. I'm 82 years old. I'm in really great shape. Beside my mind being great shape, I play pickleball 4 times a week. I go to the gym 3 times a week. I'm feeling as healthy as I have ever in my life at 82. Wow. Sometimes I do things I'm not supposed to do because, oh, I forgot I'm 82. So I was playing pickleball last week. And I 2 hours of pickleball. And when I play, I'm playing against these 30 kids that are kids, I call them 30, 40 years younger than me. But I don't see them as I'm 82 and they're 40. I'm just seeing them as they're pickleball players. So I have no, for me, it's no difference. So I played 2 hours and then we went to a party that night, my wife and I, and I was dancing the hell out of it. I mean, I hurt my knee. So, I hurt my knee. So I, you know, and now I got to go to see the doctor. I'll probably go to see him, the alternative doctor, see him later today. So I'm in great shape and I'm just hoping that maybe I could play pickleball when I'm in my 90s. But anyway, even, you know, I don't know. I just want to feel as good as I can. But for me, it's like, I went on podcasts when I was doing before I wrote the second book. I was doing podcasts for my books on, my first book. And I go on podcasts and they say, how to be healthy after 50. So how to be healthy after 50? Well, I'm 80 already. You should be healthy as hell, you know? There shouldn't be any problem with that. But anyway, one of the things is, the protein. You know, and getting back to the original things, like, I'm always asked, and vegans or people on plant-based are always asked, where do you get your protein from? Because that's the whole thing. Where do you get your, we were taught that. That was one of the manipulation games that were going on from the 40s when they created these diets for people. So they wanted to push, you know, the industries, the agriculture, the dairy and the egg industries. So they were pushing this diet. And if they were waiting, I still get asked that questions. And my first answer is always, well, I get my protein where the gorilla gets its protein, the elephant gets its protein, the wild boar gets its protein, the cow gets its protein, the horse gets its protein, and even the brontosaurus, which is what was one of the biggest animals that ever lived, they got their proteins, the leaves from the trees. So that question is like, you know, forget about it. And now you look at all these elite athletes. I mean, there's in every sport, you have, I mean, Djokovic is the tennis player. He's basically vegan, and you have so many of the Kyrie Irving, and the Venus Williams sisters, and I mean from all sports, every single sport, there's so many, and I can even the Game Changers is a great video you could see documentary you could see on Netflix that talks about that, and so you have these elite athletes. And then I go out, what other proof do I have? Well, according to, the blue zone, the five blue zones in the world that wrote his book, you know, he was sent by National Geographic to find where the healthiest and longest living people in the world live.
Great
and
book.
It's a great book. And then it actually, that's also on Netflix. So if people want to know, you know, if for me, it's like if the healthiest and longest living people in the world are plant based, you know, why not? And then you have the China study by T. Colin Campbell he's a biochemist from Cornell University. Well, he's in his 90s. He's still very active now, but he was contracted by China, Chao Enlai, who died from cancer, actually. They want to fight to go. He came to China for a 20-year study, the China study, where he did find out, what is the whole deal with cancer in China, you know? And he found out what is the base, what is the foundation of the people who don't have cancer like we have in the West. We have cancer and heart disease and chronic diseases. You know, we're at the top there. The obesity. Just like Mexico, you know, Mexico used to be a healthy country. And then it started when I came here, then it started adopting the diet, the standard American diet from the U.S., which is based on, you know, meat, dairy and eggs and some fruits and vegetables and nuts. And we're among the unhealthiest people in the world. Now, I'm not saying that you shouldn't eat meat. You know, or you shouldn't, you can have it once in a while. In fact, in the blue zones, they do have a little bit of it. Yeah. You know, they'll have their meat. And also you can, you know, you won't have to take the vitamin B12. You know, you can get a little bit. But we're not carnivores. Our whole body is not carnivore body. Our bodies are made for carbohydrates. That's where we get our energy from. The carnivore, if you just look at the structure of the carnivore body, they have a very short intestine, you know, because they swallow their meat whole, and it's digested in the stomach with tremendous amount of acid that we could not even, you know, have, and our body could not deal with. And so carbohydrates, and then we're fiber people. That is the latest thing that came out of, you know, with the microbiome is the number one subject in nutrition. There's the last 5,000 studies a year on the microbiome, because they're discovering that we are, you know, we live within a microbiome, and their favorite food is fiber. And where do fiber come from? It comes from plants. And meat and the animal products don't have fiber. So if you're going to do a strict carnivore or even a keto diet, you got to be careful, because the latest research is showing that we're getting a fraction of the fiber we need, and the fiber is what good bacteria eat that help us strengthen our immune system and our bodies. So I think that you know, the other thing is that, you know, people say, well, I'm eating, you know, I'm a carnivore, I'm eating meat. And it ends up they're in their 50s and their 60s. Wait till you get to your 70s and 80s and see how you feel, you know, because the longest living and healthiest people in the world are basically plant-based.
Yeah, the other thing, too, about, you know, we're destroying our gut with the preservatives that are in a lot of the foods and drinks that we eat too. The energy drinks are the worst, but you know, it's in our food too. They sneak it in supplements, they sneak it in everything, but that's destroying our gut bacteria, which is a massive problem. That's really good information. Thank you. Question 10, how has the COVID-19 pandemic influenced your views on misinformation?
Well, that actually the pandemic just completely turned me around and made me realize the misinformation that was going on. You know, when we were, when it first came, I was, you know, everybody was scared. It was like, we didn't know what was going on with the pandemic that happened. I think it was declared in March of 2020. And that went, you know, and then we just followed it and agreed to it. And then the lockdowns came and the different protocols, you know, the masks, wearing masks, the social distancing, and the lockdown. And I was like, hey, what can we do in the lockdowns? This was the big thing for me. With the lockdowns, I was hoping that while we're in our house, that we're going to get some information on how we can become healthier so we could deal with, you know, the virus. You know, and I was waiting, and nothing was happening. Everybody was just staying home and getting fat instead of getting healthier, and getting sick instead of getting healthier. Nothing from the medical people, you know, it was like from the World Health Organization, nothing from them. It was like, and that was like, the big thing. And then another thing was happening, because this was right before the vaccines came out. I was listening. One of my favorite plant-based doctors is Dr. Michael Greger, who I get his information all the time. So he used to have, well, he still has, he has Facebook, live Facebook meetings and YouTube meetings where you can ask him questions. So I was there and listening to it, and he came up the topic of vaccines. So I asked the question, how do we know the vaccines are going to be healthy? And immediately, Facebook, he was on Facebook. Facebook, it was a pop-up. You are the only one who could see this question. You are against the community standards. That was before the vaccines. That was the first thing that happened. And I said, okay, what is this all about? And then that started me just seeing, you know, what was, where it all started and where it was going. Mm.
I won't expand on that one. What's the most surprising findings from your research on information warfare?
My surprising information. I think it was just how closed people are to all the different issues that are going on. You know, I got into this because once it started with the pandemic and the vaccines, I had to go into the other ones. I knew it was going to be other issues that are going to be popping up. So I got into the, you know, the climate change issue, and then I got into the war issue, and then I even, I got into, expanded into the nutrition, into the drugs. You know, it was, I guess, the ignorance that people were having or have about what's really going on, and they're just denying that what they know could be wrong.
That's good. Question 12, how do you stay objective in your investigative work?
Okay. I have, this was many years ago, because I got into the philosophy of Eastern philosophy, and I just realized because of experiences I've had that, it's very important to stay connected with myself. Mm-hmm. And, I met a teacher, he's still my teacher, Prem Rawat from India. And through his meditation, which I practice, I've been practicing that every day for the last 45 years, a little bit more than that. I practice every day, and I just make sure, because I don't want to get drawn into this thing with the past. I want to make sure that I see things as objective as I can. And by staying connected with myself, my inner self, maybe I could say that it's sort of like watching a movie of everything else that's going on. And I'm just, that's why I try not to get into a very negative emotional thing about this or that. I say, hey, wait a second. You remember, this is you, and that's what's going on outside of you, you know, and just, you got to maintain that separation.
That's really good. How do you verify the information that you present in your books?
Okay, well, that's my research, and that's my investigation. I don't know if I should mention a couple of them, or yeah, I go into one, it's called the Duran, Duran, and I really like what they talk about, and you know that they talk a lot about the mostly about the war that's going on, because that to me is the number one existential crisis right now. And I just see where his information is coming from. And then I check it with others that I also, so there's a list which I could actually send, you know, or people can, when they go into my website, if they ask me for that information, you know, and then Judge Napolitano, which I like also, because I like his guests. And he has usually does 3 or 4 different interviews every day of different people. And he asked them a lot of the time the same questions. So you're listening to each one, they have a different version of the answer for that, the same question. So that's another one. So there are others that are like that. And I stay away, because a lot of the, the clickbaits, you know, they want you to go on. They say, you know, oh, this, I try to get it from the horse's mouth. I try to get it from an interview of a person who I feel from my, you know, couple of years now that I could trust them. And I try to confirm what they say. And it hits me in the gut. I go along with it.
I like that. I'm a gut person too, like that. What impact do you hope your books will have on readers?
I think my books, the impact I hope is that they wake up to the what's going on. Mm-hmm. And I try to find out, you know, and sometimes I'll speak to somebody and I have a little doubt. Well, they'll just mention, you know, I'm not sure if I want to get the vaccine, the next vaccine. Maybe they got two. And they say, well, why don't you check out my book? you know, so on that. Or on health is somebody I see, you know, sometimes I saw this guy, he was playing pickleball and he's having a heart problem. He's having a hard time breathing. So I'll tell him, I say, why don't you, I'll bring my book to him. I'll let him see. And so I, to me, my book is, you don't have to believe, just like you say, you don't have to believe everything I say. It doesn't really matter because mm-hmm. we all can, you know, you're not going to believe everything I say. So just, that's not important. What's important is that you start doubting. And by when you listen to what I say, or what you say, or somebody else says, it's like it'll open up a possibility that maybe you'll question and doubt, and that it could be the beginning of a different way of looking at things.
I like that a lot. How can society combat the negative effects of information manipulation?
Well, I write that about that in my book too, is like, you know, this year was an incredible year for elections. And it was the biggest year for elections in the history of the world, actually. There was, I mean, they're still going on. You know, they just had the election in Venezuela, and you see what's happening with that. You know, so people are voting, and it's a chance that, you know, I'm not saying it will happen. We have a big election coming up in November. You know, people are going to have to decide what they want. Maybe they don't agree with both candidates on all the issues, but maybe you'll say, you know what? I agree with this one on three issues and that one only on one issue. So maybe I'll vote for that candidate, you know, and that's what happened in Europe. You know, the candidates came out and there was a lot of push against the wars. They voted against the wars. They want, they voted for culture and you know, each country's culture developed the cultures and you know, not so much, you know, maybe some voted against the woke movement. And but I think that's a chance to, you know, to do that. Plus you can, you know, protest. They did the protests in the U.S. against the thing what's happening in Israel, you know, in Gaza. And, it's funny because the protests were pulling, and I was like so happy to see the protests because I was involved in the thing with the Vietnam, and it was like, and it worked. It helped to push the U.S. of Vietnam, and they're doing this. They did the same thing that they did there. They were the police were committing violence. They don't want you to do that. You can't go against the narrative, you know. So I'm hoping. Well, you know, that's sort of taken a back seat. You don't hear much about the protests anymore. So. But that's another way. And speaking with your friends, if you, you know, get together a group and talk about these, I'm going to be involved in a book group where we're going to be talking to get together with a group and talking about these topics, and each person give their opinion and see what happens. So maybe I don't know if it's going to work. It's so powerful, the other side, but this is something that we could do.
Very good. How is living in Mexico influenced your writing?
I moved to Mexico in 1968 actually, and one of the things that happened because with my health is that I knew that Mexico used to be a healthy country, much healthier than it is now. And then it started changing because of the influx of what was coming from the US, processed foods, because it was in the 70s and 80s that the packaged food industry reached a new level. Yeah. And they could package so much easier, you know, production-wise. So that they sent that to Mexico. And then all the other products in Mexico, they used to eat so much more. Mexico was famous for its herbs to cure diseases. I had an incident. I remember when a friend of mine, we were living in this place called Xcalac, which is on the Caribbean, the Mexican Caribbean. It's now a tourist area. And we were there and two of them got sick, one with malaria and the other one with hepatitis, and there were no doctors there because it was 8 miles from the mainland. So they had their own herb doctors. There were women who took care of, they were the doctors on the on that place, and they gave them herbs, and both were cured in like 9 days. So this was the thing. And Mexico used to, the people didn't rely so much on doctors, but then it changed. And now the Mexicans are on the standard American diet, and we're number one in obesity. We're up there in heart disease. And this is the way the world is going, you know. It's just, and even, you know, there's a, even in some of the, what do you call it, the blue zones, you have McDonald's there. McDonald's entered Mexico in the 1970s, and Burger King and all the fast food. So that's what, that got me interested. And I, you know, that kept me, okay, I want to get into that. And that's what I did. I started talking. I started writing. I wrote for the daily newspaper here on plant-based nutrition. So that's what started it.
I love it. It's actually really interesting, too. To me, that perspective of getting to see what westernization of countries does, it's fascinating because you always hear about it. I mean, I always hear stories about it, but and it's so true. And, you know, like even what's happening right now in Ukraine, you know, BlackRock is basically owns Ukraine now. And guess what's going to go there? It's like America. And I mean, no disrespect to our forefathers. Actually, I don't know if I respect them or not. I have no idea. So much has been a lie. But I mean, you know, like I don't know how good the American way really is, considering what I've seen the American way turn out to be when we go drop that in other countries, along with our bombs and everything else. But I'm not going to preach. Number 19, what advice would you give other aspiring investigative authors?
I think it's be open. Because it's so easy to fall into confirmation bias, you know, or conscious dissonance. You know, confirmation bias is you just go along or you accept information that goes along with your way of thinking. That's a trap, you know, and then you have the conscious dissonance, which is that you can't accept something that goes against what you believe, you know. For example, smoking cigarettes, for example. You're addicted to cigarettes, you know, and then you find out that cigarettes cause cancer. You say, well, you got to die from something anyway, you know. So, but I would say you got to be open and don't get caught in those traps, because that's going to really stop you from being openly investigating. And you have to just do it on a daily basis, because especially on the current issues, it's information is changing every single day. 100%. So you got to really put your time and commitment to it.
I love that's perfect. That's a really good advice. How do you balance writing about such serious topics with maintaining personal well-being? In other words, you know, covering these subjects, it can take you down some really dark paths. And when we seek and find truth, you know, sometimes that truth is painful, the things that we learn, and that can really wreck our psyche. So how do you find the balance for you specifically? And I'm asking, this is actually a personal question too, is that I find out the more truth I end up finding out, the more disturbed I am, and that affects my inner peace. So how do you maintain that healthy balance of, hey, I'm finding these hard truths, but I'm also really enjoying my life too?
Yeah. Well, I think what I mentioned before is that maintaining my center, and there's things I can't control. But I find that truth, really frees me in many ways, because and knowing that I may not be able to do much about it, but I'm happy to know the truth. It's like, you know, when we were talking about where I was mentioning about the vaccines and everything, you know, once you find out the truth that the vaccines are what they all, you know, supposedly going to be, you find out the truth and you don't have to get vaccinated anymore. I'm free of that, you know? And I feel that there's freedom in knowing the truth, you know, and that's what I think the best we could do, you know. Yeah. Well, that's what I could do.
I like that. Last question. What are your future plans for your investigative work?
Okay. I'm continuing with my my website, and I have my Substack and Medium and my web Facebook page. I'm continuing because it's just changing. You know, I didn't even know when I was going to finish. I thought I was going to finish this book a year ago. And then all of a sudden, the thing happened with Israel in Gaza. And they say, uh-oh, I'm not finishing it now. And then I was like, when am I going to finish this book? And then somebody gave me the advice, you got to finish this book and just continue giving the information, like almost writing another book, but in doing articles and just keeping people in touch with what's really going on. So I don't know if I can mention something else where I'm thinking things are going, and I haven't mentioned it yet.
Well, I was actually going to give you the floor last word. So okay. I appreciate your answer, but what I would like for you to do now is to have the last word, say what's ever on your heart, and make sure you plug everything you want to plug.
Okay.
You know what plug is? Plug, promote.
Promote my
promote anything my platforms, you want.
Yeah.
Okay. And then have the last word.
Okay. So first I'll plug. I want to mention this is my first book, The Thriving Vegan, which is what I did, my first investigative book. And then I have this is the latest one, which is Information Warfare, The Battle for Truth and Freedom. That's my latest book. And I have the information on my website where you can get the book. It's on Amazon. And I also have, I'm doing my, at least once a week, Substack articles, follow-up articles on all the topics I deal with, the issues I deal with. Same with Medium, and that's what I do with Facebook. So those are the main ways of promoting my book. And you could subscribe to the website. And what I want to do to close up is talk a little bit about where I think things may be going and what I think is the real battle that's going on. And I think it's the battle between the unipolar world and the multipolar world. The United States and the West, mostly the United States representing the unipolar world, which means trying to maintain its hegemony as the number one kid on the block that it maintained since the 1990s, and it doesn't want to give it up. The United States is doing everything to stay on top, and you have on the other side of the world, the global South or the East, which you have Russia, China, and the BRICS countries, and the Shanghai Cooperative, forgot the last word. Anyway, so they're the other countries that want to go multipolar. And one of the reasons is that the United States is not fair with the countries that are it's dealing with. It sanctions countries like the Norway, you know, there's over 25 countries that are being sanctioned. And if you don't go along with the United States says, you're going to be sanctioned, or we're going to topple your government, or we're going to get somehow regime change or affect your government. And then you have the multipolar world, which not many people know about. In the U.S., you don't get much information on that. But this is a big thing happening, and it's the BRICS countries having the next meeting in October, and more countries are going to want to join because they're feeling that this is more fair. They're going to be treated with fairness. They're going to be able to share and not be exploited for their, whether they have, their whatever resources they have. They're going to be, given a chance to develop and experience peace and prosperity, a world of peace where there's no war. And that's where I think that the multipolar world wants to go. But then we have the other side that wants the war. They're the ones who are pushing the war. And I think that this is what's happening. And we're right smack dab in the middle of this right now with what's happening with, you know, with Gaza and the possibility of you know, what the Iran entering the war with Hezbollah and all. See, so we got to pay attention to this. And really, if you're listening to this podcast, watching this podcast, check out what's going on the other side of the world, because that to me could be the only hope. And I think the future is a multipolar world, and the United States should consider being part of the multipolar world instead of being, you know, having to have control of the world.